Excuse me.
That's the pre-show. Just like burp, excuse me. Welcome back to the podcast, everyone. This is Good Morning Toy World, your source for semi-premium adult-related toy content. I am your host with the most, your ghost with the most, your one and only Pepperoni. And joining me, as always, via satellite, the daddy of Diaclone, Tony. Did you want to say hello to the people, Tony?
What's up, everybody?
What's up, everybody? This is daddy of Diaclone, Tony.
It's devolved into that. We're just...
I feel like I've just been steadily devolving constantly.
We're just as disingenuous as our crazy voices.
Wow, I'm wacky.
Oh, I'm wacky. I'm zany. Subscribe to my content.
Toy personality.
Oh, man. Hairy knuckles in a light box. That's the world.
Oh, my God. You gotta do that and kind of slowly over time turn into run the cube.
Yeah.
Oh, Halo. I'm Play Twins.
Today is a special day. What is this, 123 episodes? The 1-2-3 cast?
Shit. That's amazing.
And we are having a very special guest. We are having Mr. Vomit, I believe is his name. We're having Video Vomit. You probably know him of Instagram fame. I don't know if fame's the right word.
Sofubi fame.
Instablarm. I found him on the Instablarm and then found him on the YouTubes. And steadily,
and almost 5,000 other people have as well.
Yeah, So John is going to be hanging out with us and talking some shop, and you guys asked plenty of questions for our boy.
Oh yeah, thanks again to the Discord for supplying us with a bunch of questions. Like Pep said, so that'll be pretty cool. We have a couple of our own as well.
Yeah,
maybe just one or two.
You guys made it easy for us. Like, we don't have to do homework now because you guys wrote our questions for us. We're going to be asking the hard-hitting questions like we always do. We're going to be grilling John very, very hard on many points. We're going to get a confession out of him at some point, I think.
I hope so.
Without further ado, should we get him on the call here?
Yeah, let's do it up. Hello.
Sorry about that.
It's all good.
I like how your little picture was Freddy the Freak. That's awesome.
Oh, thank you. Yeah, dude, I love that video so much. I can't get enough of that video.
Oh, it's so... I, like, recently went down the rabbit hole of that whole thing.
Yeah.
And I was like, that's...
Yeah, I even went as far as, like putting some thought, because do you watch Oni Plays All?
Yeah, you got the shirt, didn't you?
Yeah. I'm like, I really want to like message him, because I remember like looking at his Twitter feed and like someone asked the original creator of Freddy Freaker if he ever wanted to do like a toy.
Yeah.
The guy was like, yeah, I just didn't know how to go about it. And I was like, oh shit, this could be my moment.
You
know,
go
like
on.
Message him or something. Yeah. I thought that was I wanted to do that really bad, but I'm just like, well, he doesn't know who the hell I am. Like, he like, why the hell would he have my invitation? Toy out of nowhere.
I feel like it's one of those things where it's almost better to ask for forgiveness than permission.
Yeah, sure. Yeah, you'd be like, I'm sorry about this, but I have a way maybe to create your whatever you want to get done or something like that. Yeah, I've had people do that for me, and they ended up like saving my ass in the end. I'd be like, oh, thank God you messaged me.
Nice. Oh, that's rad.
I'd probably go ask myself.
Well, so we now have Monsieur Vomit, Video Vomit, in on the call. John is here talking with us. Do you want to let the people know who you are, what you are, in case they're unfamiliar?
Yeah, sure. Hello to anyone who isn't familiar. Greetings and salutations. I am Video Vomit. I made a little YouTube channel for a little while. It's still hanging in there. We're working on season 2 and stuff right now. I also, got my name, Video Vomit and stuff, by an Instagram that I recorded everything that I would, paint. I started painting, simple toys, with airbrush and stuff. And then I worked my way up to designer toys, vinyl toys, stuff like that. And then, Sofubi. And, I kind of tried to create something for myself, solely based on painting at first, and then now I have this year released my first toy, Zengachi.
Hell yeah.
And, yeah, been a really, really incredible ride, and I really wanted to take this opportunity to thank anybody who follows me on Instagram or follows the YouTube page or anything like that, or who's bought anything from me. So thank you. You know, I wouldn't have cool opportunities like this without you guys. So thank you so much. And thank you guys for having me come on the show. I really appreciate it.
Yeah, hey, without me sliding aggressively into your DMs.
No, dude, by the way.
Yeah, I've been laying in groundwork for a while now.
Yes, every time that we would, like, see each other, meet up, it was, like, that was, like, one of the first conversations we had, and I was, like, yes, 100% always yes.
Yeah.
Because I love getting involved with other people's projects and stuff like that, and I love, you know, I love working with other people because I feel like I haven't had a lot of opportunity to, but now, just now, I feel like the ball is starting to get rolling for me. Working with other people, I've been doing a lot of colorways for other people, doing a lot of shows and stuff, including like 5 points and stuff like that. And so that's been, I have been so grateful that has been a thing for me recently. And so anytime something like this happens, I am also very grateful.
Sweet. Well, that's awesome. It sounds like the Sophomy community is pretty awesome still. And
I think that I think it gives back what you put into it, right? Mm-hmm. I've been overly positive, or I've attempted to be, right? Where I try to be as forward about who I am and what I like, and like, I want, whenever I talk to people about it and stuff, I want them to feel like, oh, this guy knows what I'm knows my world, and I'm totally comfortable around him or something like that. And I think it does. Like, I think if you do kind of go in there with, you know, your fist clenched and your chest all puffed, you know, I think that people are going to be less inclined to, you know, play ball with you, if you will.
Yeah, definitely. You kind of have to be approachable to get approached.
Right, yeah. Especially if, you know, and for some people, that's kind of by design, you know, where they don't want to disclose whatever they do or their methodology or whatever. I've always been, you know, kind of like open about what I, you know, what I do and what my techniques are. And if people have questions and stuff, I love to try and help people in any way that I can, because, especially with, the YouTube show for a little while, I had gotten, that had like opened the gates for people to be like, hey, you know, how do I do this? How do I do that? How did you accomplish this goal or whatever? Mm-hmm. And I try to answer the best I can. I certainly didn't have like a conventional road, you know, like I think that everyone's journey is different. You know, everyone has like, I've been watching some of the episodes that you guys have put up, and like a lot of people have different stories and stuff. And I think that's really cool because, you know, like in life, right? No one took the same freeway to get where they are. They had to create their own trail or whatever. And especially around here where there's absolutely nobody doing this and there's no support, it's great to have support from people, and especially people feeding that when they ask you questions or whatever, because then you might learn something yourself. You know, there's always going to be somebody out there who knows more than you do. So I don't ever want to pretend like I know everything. You know, and I'm always constantly being humbled by this community, which is really, really cool, because I think that's a way to, there's no like patriarch or whatever, you know, so.
There's no king. Well, maybe Max Toy might be the king of Sophobia.
Yeah, right now, yeah, but definitely. I mean, that's how I got into it, so.
Oh, sweet.
That was like the first, you know, taste. I remember seeing those. I think I saw them in a magazine before I saw them online, I think.
Oh, yeah.
I suppose, or something like that. I'm not really sure. But I remember seeing them, and it was the cats, the small Nagoras, like the really small.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, those ones are cool.
And I was just like, oh, God, no. You know, I'm a cat person. So, like, anything cat stuff, I'm all about. So, yeah, I definitely, that opened the floodgates, right? And then from there on, I was just like, well, you know, I'm already involved, so I might as well. Like, I remember buying, like, a white blank one, and I was like, okay, you know, like, I really want to paint this. I really want to do something with it. And I painted it, and I hated it. I hated it. I was like, you "Oh, dude, you suck."
I broke my toy.
Lately, just started over. You know, I was like, yeah. I want to get better at airbrushing. I want to get better at all that stuff. So I started painting on Kenner Predator and Kenner Swamp Thing.
Oh, sweet. Yeah, yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Actually, I think...
That's kind of how I got, like, where you know, my following on Instagram is mixed. You know, you got your tape heads, you got your horror people, you got your vintage action figure people, and then you have your Sufubi people. And I try to, like, you know, throw meat to every...
A little bit for everybody, yeah.
Yeah. And so, like, that's kind of how it really got started, was people being like, this guy is, you know, he's cutting apart toys, he's making Franken toys, he's, you know, painting all this weird stuff. This is, you know, what is this guy doing? This is super weird. And then it kind of, like, evolved and morphed into a more focused and condensed kind of style with painting or kit bashing or something like that. Not so much kit bashing anymore, but I want to get back into that because I kind of have a better control of it. That's where I was like, let's just put shit all over everything. Yeah. Okay, let's create a narrative here and let's, like, around the piece or whatever, you know, kind of artist brain has to has to work it out, make it logical, if you will.
The road you said that everybody takes to get where they're at, like, but all of the steps you took seem to lend so beautifully into the realm of, like, sort of grotesque Sofubi and art. Like, it all makes so much logical sense. You know what I mean?
Yeah, yeah. They're like it's like stepping stones or whatever. I think that's kind of by design, not. It's like kind of like a subconscious thing, because, you know, everyone knows, you know, behind me, I don't know if they're not going to be able to see this, but no. Behind me, I have a shit ton of horror posters. I got a Slimer.
Oh, yeah.
I got horror shirts on and stuff. Like, horror is definitely the spark that had created creativity for me as a kid. You know, along with, of course, anime and cartoons and, you know, all that stuff. But I think horror is what really, jump-started my imagination as a kid, because it scared the shit out of me. And I think nothing motivates a young brain and molds it more than fear does. So I was horrified by, you know, some of the, like, I had seen The Blob at a really young age, the Kevin Dillon remake. that was super gory and super vicious.
It was. I was not expecting that the first... Because, like, you think of The Blob and you think of, like, the black and white. Was it the 50s or...
I think it... Yeah, it was in color. But yeah,
was it?
Yeah, the effects on there were pretty... pretty fun.
Okay, I guess I watched it on an old school black and white TV.
Oh, yeah, yeah. Hey, it was probably better than black and white.
I'm going to go with it was.
Yeah, I don't know. Maybe I saw a colored version.
Oh, yeah, I'm not too sure. But yeah, no, and then you jump into the remake and it was like, people are getting, like, their faces melted off, and it's amazing.
Into a drain, the guy gets pulled into a drain.
Yeah, that's right.
The first, the character that you think is going to be, like, the hero, it's coming slime, and then he dies, and, like, the chick pulls his arm off and stuff. Yeah, yeah. And you're just like, what's happening? You're not supposed to do this good. In the movie. You're breaking all the rules, you know? Yeah. I saw The Fly at a really young age. I remember, this is funny, but you remember that thing on VH1, like the I Love the 70s, 90s, or whatever? I remember watching those with my mom, and every time a horror movie would come up, you know, like Science of the Lambs or Texas Chainsaw Massacre or anything like that, I'd be like, can we go rent that? You know, and like it was, and then there's that Bravo's 100 scariest movie moments of all time or whatever. And I remember watching that, and that's how I found out about, like, Suspiria and a bunch of, like, really, really, like, obtuse, obscure horror movies that I never would have been introduced till much later in life or something like that from community or whatever. And so I saw a lot of stuff I probably wasn't supposed to at a very young age. So,
I feel like that happens to a lot of us that are kind of into this sort of stuff as well.
That's what's really cool too is that I think one of the main lines through, like, the gross out, or, you know, like, the more grotesque looking Sufubi creators, that, you know, it was really created by, like, the horror thing, because you know, you can see a lot of influence and stuff like that. And I love that. You know, I love seeing the Lucio Fulci zombie, you know,
and
love seeing the, you know, Cropsey from The Burning or something like that in there. And I'm just like, oh, dude, like that, to me, that makes, that's a way of speaking to other people that really enjoy that stuff. Mm-hmm. And it's a way of like clicking with them immediately. You don't have to have a conversation with them. You need to know what they look like. They're like, this artist understands me. This is why I need it on my shelf or whatever. So.
Yeah. I found it also like speaks to the people that are kind of like, they have vague recollections of seeing those movies or like parts of those movies, just like burying it in their subconscious. Like, oh, that was so terrifying. I'll just never remember it. And then like, you know, scrolling through your Instagram and you're like, oh my God, that is so revolting. And I don't know why it's like affecting me the way that it is. And you're like, oh, that's, yeah, this is like a weird thing that I saw when I was a kid. That's amazing.
Memories of the man bear pig.
Yeah.
It was like, where did that come from? I had no idea, you know? Yeah. Horror is, I think it is definitely one of my top influences along with like late 70s to early to mid 80s Japanese culture and stuff like that. Yeah, I think I think like that Saturday morning cartoon, you know, kind of like Shogun Warriors or you know, even more of your like Transformers or something like that. I think that those were like a lot of the solid building blocks for Zengachi as a character and like creating him.
Cool. Yeah, there's a lot of like Getter Robo vibes I was kind of like picking up from him as well.
Oh, yeah. I like his stance. He has this like, he has this, just like proud stance. And it's also,
his
profile kind of like fits with that like way that they all line up on the shelf or something like that. I remember also the Doku Rocks, like Skull Toys and stuff like that. That they were a huge influence on Zengachi.
Sweet.
Yes.
Hey, just bust it out casually.
Whip it out. No, I'm just kidding. definitely.
All my vinyl's packed up right now. I gotta.
Yeah. you're like, hold on one second, you get out of box cutter.
No, I actually found an entire Rubbermaid full of my my Ultraman and Godzilla Safabi stuff.
I'm on a big Godzilla kick right now. Now that you know the hype fed for the new one has come out and stuff, and I'm just like, oh my God, yes, like. So I've been like revisiting some of my favorite Godzilla movies and stuff like that.
Sweet. That being said, though, since we're talking about grotesque and all that other stuff, what's your take on the new Shin Godzilla design? Do you love it? Do you hate it? Can you do without it?
I love it. I do. I haven't really encountered anyone who hasn't really liked it or like hated it or anything. But
okay.
I guess in my thought process, I never really take anybody else's opinion.
That's fair.
I'm selfish that way. I look at it and it's been like said in a ton of like analysis videos for Shin Godzilla and all that kind of stuff. But it invokes to me. It looks a lot like the original Godzilla in the sense of like the radiation burns and stuff like that. I think that more in a. The director's name is like slipping my mind right now, but he did like
Anno
and stuff, and I think that was like a perfect fit because the scale is something that he has a really good eye for, even in cartoon form. It's he has a really good eye for it. So seeing, like, I think the images that kind of sticks out for me, not just the purple beam part. But where you, the first time you see that, you're like,
oh, he like unhinges his fucking lower jaw like a snake. Yeah, it was
really cool, and I was really happy to see it in theater and for the first time. I love his teeth. I love his tiny eyes. I love the forms. I love the googly eyed. You know, his like.
Yeah.
apparently, that's his second form when we first see him or whatever.
Yeah, he's just the tail, and
then I think maybe where people might have a problem is the ending. You know, the fact that there might be humanoid Godzilla creatures running around. We'll get flashbacks to the Matthew Broderick, you know, time of Godzilla. I think this would be cooler. I think it'd be scary as shit to see, you know, like a Train to Busan type situation.
Yeah, yeah. Well, it's funny because at first I was like, okay, the concept of like him shooting tail babies out that looked like that, it's like if it was anybody but Anno.
Right.
Then I'd be like, that's dumb. But it's like, oh, this is the Evangelion guy. Yeah, okay, that makes sense.
Everything's bizarre and weird. Who cares?
Yeah.
So back, like, relax.
He's having fun for the first time in like 20 years. Let him do it. He's
gonna be having fun until people start a best girl war.
That's the other thing is that it's brought some really cool creative lore or whatever to the Godzilla franchise. Mm-hmm. Like, I'm excited to see if I don't know if they're doing another one, but it would be really, really cool to see what happens next or where they could go with that or what, like, what would one of the classic, you know, like what would Gigan look like or something like that? That'd be, you know, like just going off of these and some designs, like, or I would love to see like some kind of like angel situation, like from Andreas, is like that, like, so it just lands on the earth and it's just like, we gotta unfreeze Godzilla. He's gonna kick our ass. So that'd be
really, it's cool. Gotta have an emotional breakdown to Wagner playing in the background.
More classical music in the background. It gives me goosebumps. I love it.
That's yep.
Like whatever, oh, man. Whatever gives me goosebumps in the theaters. I'm just like, oh, okay, all right, I'll see this.
Yeah, totally. Yeah, no, I was pleasantly very surprised with all of it. It's funny because the first thing that I really didn't like was the tiny beady eye.
Mm, yeah.
Like it reminded me of like one of those Easter chocolate bunnies.
Yeah.
But then it grew on me so fast, and everything else like was just like, oh my god, this is disgusting. I love it.
Long, like nature, you know, and his big old cellulite thighs. I love those. Mm. His messed up ass dude needs a pedi because his
nails are got some wet. Janky ass toenails. Yeah, they're like coming out from the top of his foot. It's like that's not right.
No wonder he looks pissed off. He's like shaking his head all over. He's like, ah, I got a hangnail. It's killing me.
My life is pain.
Why? I bet it's like walking on a city of Legos.
Can you imagine how often Godzilla's stubbing his toe, man? Like, all day, every day, buddy's stubbing his toes. That's why his nails are all fucked up.
Oh my god, yeah.
I am a mattress, and then he'll be totally cool from now on.
Oh, man.
I think I've ever said.
Oh, don't worry. You're in good company.
You still have plenty of time left.
You're fine. I'm sure stupider things have been said and will be said.
Oh, man, we've got a back catalog of, what is it, 122 episodes where Tony and I do nothing but say stupid shit.
Hey, that's where some of the best stuff comes from.
Yeah. Oh, totally.
When you're on the bottom of the barrel. Like, I didn't see this. This is good. Yeah.
I can't wait for, like, 5 years from now for somebody to take a clip out of context and ruin both Tony and I's careers. It's going to be fucking tight. Yeah. No.
That's, you got to have you gotta have one hand over the destroy the entire back catalog button.
Just the memory purge.
Just, like, nope, a text from Tony. It's like, we got to go full atomic. It's like, all right, it's gone. Podcast never existed.
I'm gonna set my solid state on fire. It's okay.
Yeah.
Yes. I feel like my old videos where I just like want to delete some of my older videos, and that there's a one bunker episode video where we messed up the audio somehow, and it was like I was reviewing 1000 toys and like and some Acid Rain figures and stuff. And we uploaded it, and I went home. Like, I left the studio, I went home, and I put on the video. I was like, let's see, you know, how it turns out. Let's see it on my TV. And just the audio was so screwed up, and I was like, ah! I was like, what do we do? And there was, like, nothing we could do at that point, so I was just like, we could pull it down and then, like, put up another version or whatever. And by that time, all the people had left the studio, so I was just like, all right, well, I don't want to delete the video, so let's just keep it up. And
yeah,
get your comments on there, like, audio's weird, dislike. I'm like, no! I'm sorry.
Of course, fickle bastards, always... why?
Yeah. It always seems like something would go wrong, you know, while recording or something. That's part of the plot. That's part of the live, like, whole thing, right? You probably know what the hell I'm talking about, where I'm sure, like, one small thing would go wrong during your live thing, and you're like, keep going, keep rolling.
No, it's more like a series of, like, 100 small things going wrong, and I'm just like, at this point, yes. It doesn't matter. I'm trash, and so is everyone who's watching.
Keep going.
Yeah.
I feel like the worst that's happened for us so far, other than, like, me just being in, like, a pissy mood and trying to pick fights with other podcasts, is, that's never happened. But, like, there is a time where, like, my, like, a recording software just cut out completely, and I wasn't rocking the two monitors at the time, so I was like, oh, shit, how much have we lost? It was about, like, half an hour's worth of...
Oh no! Let's go back.
Just
and
no run. Audio on my end. Yeah, just like we're talking about Hot Wheels. Oh shit! Okay, go back. I'm gonna pretend to talk about Hot Wheels again.
Hot Wheels, huh?
I mean, we're big Hot Wheels collectors.
Oh my god!
Oh, nice.
Do you know how insertable they are?
Oh, stop!
One condom away from
from what? I have a series of x-rays that
that's gotta be some kind of subcategory for some kind of porn.
They call me
the Albert Fish
of Hot Wheels.
Like, even like Weeble Wobbles or like little Fisher Price adventure people.
Oh no, not the the submarine dude.
It's the final adventure.
The spaceman is the space people had nice dome helmets.
Oh, they did. You're right.
Wow, I've got the.
Yeah, this is another lost
episode. Going on an
for
adventure.
Sure.
It's in their name. Designed for this.
I wanted to talk a bit of shop. So you've done DesignerCon before, yes?
Yes, yeah.
So
that was my first year last year.
Last year, and this year really? It's changing significantly. And I wanted to get your take on it because I've been sort of watching it all happen online, and it's really interesting. Like all of the different opinions people have. Of how DCon is changing, and I'm very curious to hear your thoughts.
Okay, so I like I said, you know, last year was my first year, so I think I'll have a certain type of I won't say nostalgia goggles, but my judgment is clouded because of you know it was my first time, and everyone was so cool to me, and like everyone there. Was so nice and everyone there was so supportive. And I met, I met the late great John Schnepp there.
Oh, nice.
So, you know, that was really cool experience. I got to meet Alex Pardee, which was like high school me would have been like pissing himself.
Yeah.
Are you the upper playground guy?
Sorry, what?
It's like, are you the upper playground guy?
You're the walrus man. So I'll look at that very, very fondly. I'm hoping that I'm going this year. I still have to coordinate what's going to happen with me. Hopefully I can get Zingachis, and if not, I'm probably just going to go as like a fan. And I haven't done that yet for any of our little toy designer toy functions yet. I haven't gone as just like a fan yet. So I'd really like to do that. But to get to your question, I'm mixed on it a little bit. I think my biggest concern about it is and I don't want to like stir any shit with anybody, but I think the Funko inclusion is probably my biggest.
Are you telling me you don't want some Funko cereal?
I think that that there is other cereal other places. And I think it's probably more delicious. I would probably trust Kellogg's over a toy manufacturer to get me my cereal. But I don't know. That's just me.
Yeah, maybe that's just me. Maybe it's just me on this one.
But that's coming from guys buying hot sauce from metal bands before. So
nice.
You know, or barbecue sauce from metal bands before. Well, barbecue sauce is good. Hot sauce, not so much.
Well, I mean, like, it kind of makes sense. In a weird way, I'm like, yeah, I'd probably do the same thing too. I don't blame you.
But yeah, for I mean, the change in location, and it's 3 days now, mm-hmm. instead of the two that it was. There was a lot of people there, you know, and it was a big place that we were in last year, and there's still a lot of people. There's still a lot of lines. I was at a booth where there was a lottery going on. That was like my first time there. You know, I had gotten the full blunt force of it, you know, like having, you know, like 100+ people just hanging around the booth waiting to get there. Not for my toy, but, for Chen's toy. It was a lot of fun. It was so crazy and hectic, but there was a beautiful mess to it all. I loved it so much. So I can only imagine it's going to get even crazier. I can see why people would have a problem with that expansion, right? You kind of, right now, I can imagine people would feel like, you know, I don't want any more competition to get the things that I want. You know, I can definitely understand that. But also, the thing that's totally imperative about our culture is that we need constant refreshment, right? Because if there's the same people doing the same things, into the same things, only buying the same things, that mm-hmm. that tends to get stale real fast for people. I can say for myself, my style, what I'm into, is constantly changing, and what I'm into or whatever. I'm always evolving as in my tastes are concerned or whatever, and as an artist, I guess. So I can see why people would be upset, but also it's really important that we get fresh blood, if you will, or, you know, because I think that, you know, like myself, I was new not too long ago. I would still consider myself fairly new to this world because it's only been, you know, like 6 years, I think, maybe so far since I've been heavily into it, you know, constantly thinking about it morning, noon, and night, you know? And then, the change of location, I think that's just, you know, it sucks that, you know, we gotta hang around tourist trap locations and stuff, but. Yeah, you know what? It is what it is.
Yeah, if it's a trade-off for a bigger, more like well placed out,
I'm assuming there's a lot more hotels that are in the area. Yeah, maybe they're not as affordable. I don't know. I've never been to Anaheim before, but
as far as I remember, like as long as you're not staying in Disneyland, you're okay.
Oh yeah. Okay. So yeah, I think. Yeah, I mean, like all of this stuff. This is. You know, whether we like it or not, these kind of functions are kind of a mainstream thing now. I think more people know about them than not now, whether it's DesignerCon, San Diego, New York, whatever. Mm-hmm. You know, I think a lot of people are going to, you know, they're going to know about it. They're going to talk about it. People are going to report about it. People are going to make podcasts, make videos about it and stuff. Mm-hmm.
A podcast, you say?
No more. I want to know. Can you show me? So, you know, I'm not as bent up about it as certain people are, but I'd say just, you know, if you're going and you're worried about it, just throw it away. You're gonna get some toys, man. You're gonna have
some exactly. Fun. Like, no one's gonna be forcing you to
eat cereal,
buy something from the cereal vendors.
Just big old Funko gun to your head, like eat the fucking cereal, man.
It tastes like cardboard.
And eyes on it. It's like a nice fat plump gun.
Yeah, I feel like a lot of people overreacted. Which is fair. I mean, like it's big.
Yeah, I
it's
feel
big
like we
scary
did.
Change.
You're right.
Well, there's the whole like get your chocolate out of my peanut butter.
Yeah,
sort of thing.
But yeah, I honestly think like if people are concerned that it's going to be more competition for the things that they like, maybe over time. But this first year, I feel like it's going to be a split crowd. Like there's going to be people who are there strictly for Mondo, for Metacom, for Funko, and they're gonna love it, and they're gonna have something to obsess over and be excited about. And of course, there's gonna be bleed over into the smaller things, but that's a positive, I think. Like, more people seeing something for the first time and being like, yo, what is this Zengachi? Like it might... Yeah, yeah. It'll bring new people in, and I don't think it's just gonna, like... I think the fear is that some people think, like, it's gonna destroy the con because everybody's gonna be there to buy the shit there for. And I don't think that's gonna be the case.
Yeah.
No, I think we... Oh, sorry.
You're good.
We brought it up, like, a long, long time ago on the podcast. We brought it up a couple more times since, too. But if you're using Funko Pops as your gateway drug to, like, get into some, like, really, really cool stuff, then that's totally cool.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, I've definitely gotten into Twitter arguments with people about Funko Pops before. And that's very unlike me. I don't know how to be cool. I do hate them, but I don't hate people that collect them because it's just like, we all started somewhere. Just because I started at a different, you know, I won't even say tier. I'll just say I started somewhere else. There's a very large spectrum, you know, like, that'd be like shitting on somebody for starting collecting like designer toys because they started collecting like bear bricks or something like that.
It's yeah, just, exactly.
Like what holds more credibility over what? Is it less cool because it's more readily available to people? I will say though, I Funko, why do you gotta like hop on a train after like it's been established already? Like the Hikari thing, I'm not really cool.
Yeah. I don't know if that's actually really done that well for them either, because I don't see as much of it coming out.
We see them on sale places. And also, I think it's a really, like, call me an asshole if you want, but like, I think it's a pretty shitty move to go premium Japanese vinyl and then you look at the foot and it says made in China. Like,
yeah,
come on.
It's...
And then, like, I'm buying them. I've already, but those horror He-Man Savage World figures.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. I think, like, okay, so, oh god, okay, alright. So Funko, I noticed that what they'll do is they'll see what other, you know, smaller creators are doing, and then they'll go, we can do that on a huge fucking scale, let's do that, you know, so.
Yeah, exactly.
I don't know, you know, like, they have the reaction figures, I know that they started that with Super 7, kind of, sort of, and stuff. And then they kind of, like, took that and ran with it, and now Funko can't do their own, like, parody, you know, He-Man type stuff because Funko is doing their own Savage World stuff. Yeah. That sucks because it's like, I would have really liked to see, you know, because I really like what Super 7's doing with their reaction figures or their vintage line and stuff, and then the catching and stuff like that. I really enjoy reinterpretation or adaptation of things like the Robotech vintage style figures.
Yeah, those are cool.
Those look so cool. I really want some of those, and so I always want to see more stuff like that. And then, you know, like I make every Halloween, I'll make a Playmate style horror icon figure. Like last year, I made a Michael Myers out of some of the old Dick Tracy Playmates figures.
Oh, cool.
So I'll like put Sculpey over them and stuff, and it's like a one off personal kind of like collection or whatever. So I'll put the date on there and stuff. And I just hope, and like maybe if someone takes that and they run with that, that'd be super cool because like I could never do that on the scale that like Funko could or something like that. So maybe I'm just, you know, getting myself riled up for nothing, but I think it's just so weird to see them like kind of like take other people's ideas and then go like, here, everyone, have at it, you know?
Yeah. Give us the money instead of them.
Back to the Hikari stuff. I think like ultimately it's just sort of tone deaf. Like it's like here is this premium Sofubi figure, but people who have an interest in Sofubi and know a little bit about it would see that it's like, okay, that's just an imitation. And then people who collect like Funko Pops would be like, oh, that's not really for me, but they might collect it because they do them limited. Like, because Funko has this amazing thing where they tell you which one you should scalp. They'll like, they'll put the sticker on it and they're like, this is the chase, man. Fucking elbow as many kids in the head as you can to get this one. And then you can sell it on eBay, my guy. But don't keep two for yourself. So they do that. But with the Hikari stuff, I think they're limited. So, like, they'll be numbered. I think they only make, like, 1,000 or whatever. So it'll be, like, it's like, this is rare. And it's, like, I don't know. It's about as rare as any of the other Hikaris you've done. Like, they're on sale online everywhere if you really want them. So I think, like, they do sort of see what they think people want and try to make more of that. But as with any big corporation and any big company, ultimately are tone deaf and don't really fully understand what people want. But once they found their formula, they'll replicate that over and over, hence the Funko Pop. It's like the Funko Pop is the Beanie Baby that worked. Like, it's still it's still relevant for people.
They're paperweights to me. But also, I don't know if they're called yet. But they're like, they look like those Nintendroid. They're like Funko's interpretation of the Nintendroid. They have like round heads, tiny, stubby arms and legs and stuff.
Was that the candy sugar thing?
Is
that different? No, rock sugars actually look okay.
Okay.
There's like some new ones that they just, I like saw the pre-order on Big Bad Toy Store and stuff.
Okay.
But they look a lot like Nintendroids. They're made by Funko. And they're orbs, but they're like these, they're like Funko's new like interpretation of the Nintendroid. I'm like, you can't even do that right because you don't even want to do the amount of articulation or accessories that all those Nintendroid figures do. I don't even know if I'm saying it right.
I'm gonna nerd out for a moment and say Nendoroid.
Nendoroid. Okay. I'm completely illiterate. I don't know what the hell I'm looking at half the time, and I'm looking at the box. I'm like, yeah, okay, I'll make up my own word, I guess.
Well, there's a bunch of Zelda ones, so that was from Nintendo, and I think they're technically robots. Yeah, Nintendroid.
Yep.
I have like the Joker Harley Quinn one. I got the Deadpool one. I got the Venom Snake from MGS5.
Those ones are cool. He comes with like a tiny box as well, right?
Yeah, it has a tiny box. They're numbered as well. They have like little windows and stuff, and like the Deadpool one came with like boxer shorts. He came with like little bubbles, like little clouds for his like dialogue and stuff, which is
cool. Nice. Okay.
I like stuff like that.
So Funko's doing an imitation, like something like a chibi style, like mini figure thing.
I would say probably like maybe like injection mold or something like that, like some kind of variation of vinyl or something like that. I think it's like 3 points of articulation. I think like the arms and the head or something like that. Mm-hmm. And then they have like, I think they have like interchangeable hands. Like I think the Freddy has like the needle hands he can put in his hands instead of the regular claw or whatever. Yeah, I don't know. If anyone's listening to this, go check it out. Put it on Big Bad Toy Store or something like that.
Let us know what you think.
So wait, are you down for these?
I think that the Nintendroids how do you say it again?
Nendoroid.
Okay. So I think that they're really cool, but I was also listening to your guys' conversation about the Acid Rain figures. It's definitely along the same lines as that, where if you live somewhere else, it sucks for shipping, and they're really expensive, and having 2 or 3 of them in like a little nook on your shelf or something like that might not be worth the like $80 for your small collection. Maybe this is like a good alternative. Like, again, I'm not gonna shit on people who collect Funko because, you know, because
they're just following orders.
you have that Funko gun on your head. Yeah. What are you going to do? I can't blame you for that. You collect what you collect, right? I think that like some people would, you know, that could go with anything. Like, oh, you collect NECA? F you. I don't know. What's that guy diehard about? NECA or whatever.
not anymore, at least. It's the McFarlane NECA war is over.
Yeah.
NECA won that one.
That's settled, I think. McFarlane, make his sports figures and hang out.
Yeah, he found his own Funko Pop. He's just like, Just collect the entire team. We're cool.
Well, he likes sports a lot, so let him and his sports buddies sports it up. And
yeah, it makes sense for like the creator, so it's like, okay, all right. Enjoy, dude. I need to get bouncing in about 10 minutes. But again, like I was saying too, you guys definitely keep chatting after I'm gone, because...
Yeah, dude.
Tony has to rest in pieces.
Dude, I'm having a move month. That's
for sure. Oh. Yeah, dude. Like... I understand that, dude. If you're a collector and you hear another collector saying, "Oh, I'm moving," you're like, "Oh."
Yeah.
No, sorry.
that's where I'm at right now.
You know, like, there's days, hours, minutes of hell for them.
Yeah. But once it's all reset up and like the new room to display it is all done and finished, it's going to be amazing. Like, I'm actually stoked that I can actually display stuff that I've had kind of in cold storage for a while. But like, I don't know. I'm an out of box collector.
Yeah, yeah.
And just getting rid of boxes and recycling all the inserts and stuff like that. Like that's the big pain in the ass. Like, I actually had to phone like a junk removal thing, because it's like, I can't just keep packing up empty boxes. And like, the way that the recycling works here is, if they for any reason don't feel like or don't want to pick up your stuff, they'll still leave it out there. So it's like, I'm just like, fine, fuck, whatever, I'll call a guy with a truck. And anyway, yeah. Sorry, that's my life stuff.
So maybe before Tony bounces, I had a spooky thing I wanted to share with guys, because Tony loves spooky stuff, former host of a spooky podcast, and you're obviously... You're a spooky guy. So, there's a big lead up. There's so much backstory. My friends bought a house. Congratulations to them. They are now homeowners.
Thank you.
And the place, essentially the only thing that's going to be left once they redo stuff is like the structure and the roof. Like, this place is gnarly. The guy who used to live there was cooking drugs. He was synthesizing acid, I believe. So there's all these like, and he died. So this is where the spooky stuff starts coming in.
Okay.
So there's like boxes of like it's like unsoluble in water, unknown compound A, in like a jar, in like a box in their kitchen. That's the floors rotting out. And I'm going through the basement in their spooky house last night. They told me it was a housewarming, and I showed up to the house from Stir of Echoes, and I was like, all right, here we go. But there was all
happy housewarming. Here's a bottle of isopropyl alcohol.
Welcome to our abode. Don't take your shoes off. And in the basement, there's all these old computers, and I was like, this is how we summon ghosts in 2018. I'm going to go through...
That's how the beginning of evil speak happened.
I'm going to go through some dead guy's computers. And so I start pulling things out of boxes and plugging things in and getting computers booted. And I boot up this old, like, HP that's got, like, Windows XP on it. And I'm like, yes, I need to find out what kind of porn the dead guy watched. Like, I need to go through this hard drive. Unfortunately... Yes. It was totally wiped. There's nothing on it. I'm like, okay, he cleared this one. So I pulled the next one from the pile. And I
really smart of him for wiping it before dying.
So,
no, it was Ken's porn, let's be honest.
I forgot. I was allowed to take the thumb drives. My buddy was like, have those if you want. And I'm like, I don't want to plug them into my computer. What if that's where the ghost is in those thumb drives?
Yeah.
I'm going to leave the ghost at your house. But I found this old laptop.
Like, flying around.
And I open the old laptop, and it boots up in DOS. And instantly, I just remember being a kid, and I'm like, all right, DIR, what's on this computer? And load up the DOS files. And Tetris, boom, 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 I'm slamming in commands. We got Tetris working. Like, 1987 red and white text version of Tetris is going. And I'm like, this is incredible. And I'm like, shit, on this little label he has written, it says it's got Windows 3.1 on it. And I had just spent, like 10 minutes trying to open me.jpg in DOS. Which you can't do, and I'm like, I need to know. So I got Windows going.
It's a cursed image. Haven't you read Creepypasta before?
And I opened it up, and I found a photo of the dude on this old laptop. And the best part was, he just looked really happy. And I was just stoked, and I got ghost closure. And I was like, what a weird, wonderful evening that was.
So I printed it out, and it's framed in my room.
No, Logan, you are not giving me another ghost photograph again. Ever since I got that picture from you, shit went downhill.
All of my cereal turns into Funko cereal. I don't know. It's a very specific curse.
They're like tiny, they're the keychain heads of the Funko Pops, and they like smash your teeth. You're like, nah.
Oh no. I hate it.
But yeah, I thought you'd find that spooky and interesting.
That is spooky. Oh, man, I'd love to have gone into a weird abandoned crack house to find just a wall of computer monitors and stuff.
Yeah, it was pretty dope. Oh, and there was a VHS video camera there that I wanted to test, because I want that. Ooh. If it still works.
Oh, yes.
Yeah.
Dude, that's dope. That's like some of the best horror movies are filmed on shit like that.
Oh, totally, yeah.
I should just film a horror movie in his basement while they're still working on it.
Yeah, right?
Just do it.
The setting is here.
Yeah.
I kind of wanted to do that while my place was being renovated, but...
Ghost Chemist from Hell. That's like the perfect name for
that. That's actually would be a really good premise for a horror film. It's like I'm super into like cracking the code, hacking this laptop, figuring out who owned it, and the ghost like totally likes me but hates everybody else. So I get a ghost pal, but he wants to torment them. And I'm like trying to talk him down. It's like, can you stop making my friends' walls bleed and stuff? Like, I know we're pals, but they're my pals, so you gotta treat them like pals. Like, what don't you get, ghost?
As long as his voice is bit crushed like shit, I will. Then I'll accept that. It's be like Altered Beast or something like that.
Yeah. I'm gonna start you on a Game Boy cartridge. Keep you in my pocket.
Yeah, no, that's how you talk to him. You keep him on a Game Boy and you carry him around with you, and he has like his scary faces on the Game Boy.
Oh yeah.
Kill them.
I'm not gonna kill them. I'm just trying to get a sandwich. Like, murder everyone in this delicatessen.
And then he'll play the Lavender Town song until you go insane.
Yes.
I don't.
From Pokemon.
Oh, I know. I'm just like, I don't know. That's just such a soothing song, though. I don't know if I can go insane.
It'll drone on. It'll get louder and louder. Until
there you go. It'll turn into the creepypasta version of it. Yeah. Oh, man. I love Pokemon Creepypasta. That's, like, one of my favorite ones. I'm just, oh.
It's a very dark rabbit hole to go down. I think it is. Any one of those stories or anything like that. Shameless plug for my friend. There's this guy, Trevor Henderson. He's a really great artist. On Instagram, and he's been doing like this like series of creepypasta like art. So he'll like take like a photo of some kind, and then he'll like paint his like creepypasta image onto it, and it's really, really cool. Ooh. So yeah, definitely check that out if you're into that kind of stuff.
Do you want to say the name one more time again? For the people?
Trevor Henderson.
Cool. I'll check that out.
He's really cool. Yeah, he has an Etsy shop too. He has like stickers and stuff.
Ooh. He's got a big cartoon. Wow, that's pretty fucking cool.
Yeah.
opening it up right away, it's like, okay, yeah, if you guys are into like spooky photo manipulations,
you're in
for a treat.
There's some that I'll look at them and I'm like coming from the bathroom, like walking down the hall, I'm like, ah, shit.
Yeah, exactly. Like, oh man, that looks like my room.
Oh, I guess I'm standing here till sunrise.
Oh shit, this is cool. All right, yeah, he just gained himself another follower. That's awesome.
He did a commission painting of the cat-eyed boy for me, and I adore it. I have like I still have yet to make my cat-eyed boy shrine of like the manga and the toys that I have and all.
Yeah.
Painting up there and stuff. So I was like, can you make me a painting, please?
Please. Oh, that's awesome.
That's something that's great about this community that I really love is that you can, as the boss and only worker of my company, I can I can wear many hats, and then I can also give said many hats to other people. You know, like KTO, he sculpted one of my newer toys that I have in the pipeline right now. And then King Hideous Toys as well. They're brothers. They also did my Street Trash Maba zombie kind of toilet guy. And so I have those two guys in the pipeline right now. And for someone like me who has to do, like, they do everything by themselves or whatever, it is so nice to have other, like, have support or be able to lean on other people, you know, for header card art or you know, like, they want to make a comic book or they want to do all kinds of stuff, you know. Like, I think that that's so cool that you can, that people can jump in on your thing at any time, or you can jump in on somebody's, you know, project or something like that. That's like the coolest thing, because, like, even now, distance doesn't really, it isn't really a thing, because, you know, we're communicating over, you know, something where deals can be made or whatever, or...
Yeah. Instagram. All three of us are in totally different cities.
Yeah. Like, that's crazy. It's pretty cool. And yet there can still be a solid connection, a through line for everybody, you know, or everyone's, you know, totally committed to this project or something like that. That's just so cool. I love seeing things like that, or seeing collectives and stuff is really, really cool. Like, I would probably say, like, Deadly Delivery is so cool to me. I really, you know, like, all of them, all of the, I like, you know, I'm just like, oh, like, you guys are so cool. You're making, like, the coolest shit ever, you know. Yeah. Definitely, absolutely inspiring. Like, they're Deadly Delivery and True Tech definitely inspired me to make my own horror Maba zombie, you know. And so I think that that's what it's all about, right? You know, like, feeding the culture, feeding our little world we have, and creating new life. And then once we get on these, you know, new trains and stuff like that, it's really cool to see, you know, how far different artists can take things, or, or, like, you know, I see something one way, but then, you know, you can have somebody come in on a project that can completely change it. For instance, my newer toy, his name's the Toxic Rider. So if that kind of inkling of what he might look like, or, you know, like, what his, like, style might be.
Probably has,
you know,
nothing to do with Trauma.
Or Kamen Rider. There's probably nothing with that either.
I had created this Kitbashed figure from a Kamen Rider figure and a Bonehead from Toxic Crusaders line, and I had Kitbashed him into this, you know, character, and I really liked this character, and so I had, like, drawn all these, like, designs of him, and, of, like, what the Toxic Rider would look like as his final version or his final form. This is my final form. And so I had someone else do it, and I was like, how about you take the reins, like, and how about you do the art, and he killed it, and so it took its own life, and now I sent that design to KTO, and Kento did an incredible job of sculpting it and stuff. I've been teasing it here and there. I'll probably, once things are a little bit further along, I'll probably, like, do a full picture of the prototype or something like that. I've had some hang-ups at the moment with some of his jointing. So. I'm the type of person who's very superstitious, and I don't like to announce things before, like, it's happening, it's gonna happen. Like,
yep, that's safer that way.
I think being traumatized by my experience trying to get my first toy made, like, it's coming, I promise, don't let the hype die, and, like, trying to, you know, like, keep that hype alive for my toy and stuff like that. That was definitely really hard, especially not knowing when it was gonna come out, or if it was gonna come out or anything like that. Especially being so new as well, and not knowing, you know, the ins and outs yet, or not knowing, like, what's typical, what's not normal, for stuff like that. And then, you know, and then being like, hey, this isn't right. It's taking longer than it should, or something like that, you know. Luckily, I'm in great hands now, and things have been going very smoothly for me, knock on wood, like I said, very superstitious. but yeah. So I'm actually going to send out the Maba sculpt probably within the next couple weeks, and that'll get casted in, like, probably resin or something like that. And then maybe down the line, if it does better, then I would love to do, like, a vinyl version of it or something like that. You know, I love small vinyl toys. I love, you know, like mid to small vinyl toys. Of course, I love the big guys. You know, those are a lot of fun. But it's cool to see the ingenuity and thought that goes into making smaller toys and, like, making their articulation work or something like that. Because there are a lot of limitations. And I'll use that word lightly, limitations, to Sifubi, where, you know, it's like it's harder to do something. You can accomplish it. You just have to think of the proper way to do it. You know, there are so many really cool figures out there. You can pull from like Ultraman Sifubi or Godzilla Sifubi, where you're just like, this is such a crazy design. How did they get that? How did they, like, they had to hear that to get that to work or whatever. Or, so that's really cool to see how people use smaller stuff, especially with, like, articulation stuff. And like I was talking about KTO, he does a really great job at making I love his style when it comes to making smaller toys and stuff like that. So that was really cool. Like his newer Gaki zombie is really, really cool. I got him right here to show you guys.
Oh, nice.
Yeah, he's really cool. I really like it. That's rad. And so he's you know, he's not super small, but I do really enjoy how, you know, I like the he's got his legs squished together, you know, the torso and legs are one piece, and then you got the arms and the head is another. I love stuff like that. It's really
he's a fun guy. You just like chuck him in your bag and take some pictures of him.
Absolutely. You know, keep him in your pocket or something like that. I'm definitely that person. I was that way when I was a kid. I'm that way now. I'll always have a toy with me, you know, in my pocket or in my car or something like that.
Same. Sweet. Okay, unfortunately, I do need to bounce. I'm sorry.
It's all good, buddy. Tony died, and we're going to answer the questions from the Discord.
Oh, okay, awesome. Yay.
See you guys later.
All right, see you, Tony.
Bye. Good move. I hope it goes well.
Thank you. And thank you so much again. I really appreciate you chatting and everything. So. All right, cool. See you later.
Bye.
Bye.
Cool. Yeah, if you're
these questions, yeah. I was looking over some of them on the little server here, and on the Discord, and I was like, great questions, everybody. So thank you for submitting your questions. I really appreciate that, and I'll do my best to answer all of them sufficiently and interestingly.
Sweet. All right, I'll fire right into it. So we've got Sam the Mop, who is asking, do you prefer to buy blank colorways so you can paint them? Or do you also buy a lot of standard colorways too?
I definitely do buy or go for blanks more often. If there's a colorway or something like that that really gets me, I think True Tech is a painter that I really, really enjoy. Anytime that I see one of his paintings or something like that, I'll usually try and go for them or something like that. Splurt is another painter that I really, really like his stuff. It varies from piece, but I think that there's also, I have a certain way of collecting, right? So I like to collect blanks, and I like to put them up on the blank shelf, and then I will sit there for months and I will ponder the perfect colorway for them to go to accent their vinyl, or, you know, if I have, or if I think of something else or whatever, and I just want to piss everyone off and hose it down with paint. it really depends on the piece or something like that. But like most of the time, I probably am going to go for blanks, just because that's kind of how I collect. It's kind of like my methodology, right? You know, serial killers got to have them, so I got to have them too. So, yes, I'll definitely go for more blanks probably. I do have like a little segregated area specifically for all my favorite painted pieces by other artists and stuff like that. So I definitely enjoy a good piece from somebody else. I'm not completely self-indulgent.
I'm too vain for other people's colorways.
Yeah, I feel like that's kind of how it comes off for people, but definitely not. I always feel like guilty going for painted stuff too sometimes, because I feel like I'm gonna steal that opportunity from someone else who would appreciate it more or something like that.
So have, also, have you ever acquired one that is painted up and you've just gone over it because you intended to paint that
okay,
piece?
Okay, so that is, I feel like that's a good learning experience for people who are getting into painting or whatever. I have done that before, but that was when I was first starting, and that is a definite taboo. That's a definite no-no. That's a right out of the playbook of don't do that. Ass. but yeah, so I did it on like old Ultraman stuff, you know, like the cheap Bandai stuff. And then, I had done it on another piece. I won't name what it was. You know, if you follow me from back then, you know what it was. Good for you. Great for you. but yeah, like, and everyone makes mistakes. And that's the thing is that, there isn't a for sure. There isn't a playbook. It's all proverbial, right? It's all it's kind of a, unspoken rules, or, you know, if you had a Skullbrain account, maybe you might be able to gather some intelligence and do some recon on what's cool, what's not cool to do or something like that.
Yeah.
But, you know, I didn't really have anybody. I didn't have a mentor. I didn't have anybody that brought me into it or anything like that. So it was just me being, very ambitious, you know, and stuff like that. I've definitely gotten, you know, people concerned, I will say, concerned over some of the blanks I've painted in the past and stuff.
Mm-hmm. Just because of, like, the rarity or scarcity of the piece, or?
Sure, yeah. Or you know, like, oh, that blank shit, that, you know, I think maybe some people don't like marbles being painted over, like, marbled vinyl or glittered vinyl or something like that, and I can definitely understand.
Yeah.
But then also brings into the question of, you know, it's your toy, it belongs to you. Are you going to keep it? For me, the big thing is that I've never been like the paint and then flip type. I've always been if I'm buying it, I'm buying it for myself. Because the things that I do paint, like it'll be like for a run or for one of my own toy or something like that. I feel like that's kind of how I've avoided really pissing anybody off. Or upsetting anybody, because, you know, anything I've ever really painted or whatever has been for myself and for my own painted collection. And then, but of course, I'll paint stuff for shows. I'll paint commissions. I'm actually working on a couple right now. I paint what I want on my stuff, because that gives people a good idea of what I can do, complete freedom.
Mm-hmm.
Or like, it's a great way to show your progression as an artist as well. You know, I've come a long way, I think, from some of my earlier paints, you know, where it would just be like, you know, very simple colors with each other, very experimental with, you know, like line work or something like that, accenting everything in black or whatever. Now I have all kinds of and stuff. So it's a great way to measure your progression as a painter. And I guess that'll be it for that question, because I've really hammered this one to the ground.
It's a two-parter though. So Sam continues with also,
oh, yeah.
What was the experience of designing a Sofubi toy like, and how did you go about creating the articulation points? He's getting specific, my guy.
Oh yeah. That's a great question. Thank you so much, Sam. So like I said earlier when we were talking, my whole process was a lot different than I would say a lot of other people's, or maybe not, you know. I'm not going to name names or anything, but I had gotten involved with a producer, and okay, so we'll start here. I created the characters in Gachi. At the time, he had two arms, and he still had a shark head. The shark, that head design is actually from some art, some paintings, graffiti and stuff that I did when I was in high school. And, he was called the Spaceman from Space back then. and so then I took that design and I reworked it and stuff. I was actually at my sister's house visiting, in Texas, in Fort Worth. And I was hanging out with her, and I had kind of been at a crossroads. I worked for a band and stuff for a long time. And I had kind of just said, you know, screw that. I don't want to do that stuff anymore. I kind of want to do something for myself now. Toys have always been a huge passion for me. I was collecting and painting them as a hobby, and so Sufubi, collecting things, Sufubi as a hobby. So then I decided, she kind of was like, well, why don't you make your own toy? And I go, well, I didn't really think that was possible for me, you know, et cetera. Mm-hmm. And then I started looking into it, and I got really passionate about it really fast. And so I had right then and there, in that trip, I had reworked that Spaceman from Space Design into Zengachi. And then, it starts out as drawing, right? You get your full turnaround, your front, your side profiles, and then your back. And then you take that into, you take that to your sculptor, you take it to your digital sculptor, or you're sculpting it yourself. Then you create your prototype, you know. Mine was a digitally sculpted and 3D printed prototype. And I had got it commissioned done. And then after that, I had taken that 3D printed sculpt and I had given it to this producer that me and him had agreed on working together. And after that, I had, you know, there's a line that you have, like, you know, there are tons of people trying to do this stuff. So time is probably your, you know, you kind of have to just accept that this stuff takes a long time sometimes. And because you're in a line, there's, you know, so many people in front of you, you know, some of them are big, some of them are small. So a year went by and, I guess I had gotten up to the point of wax, and then I had pretty much paid for everything at that point. And I wasn't getting any contact from said person, and I wasn't getting any replies or anything like that. So it kind of sucked for a while that I felt as though I had got, like, not scammed, but I guess I thought I had been forgotten about, you know? Mm-hmm. So, after that, I got in contact with someone else who had worked at that factory, and then it just picked up again. And he's like, yeah, I found it. I'll get you some pulls and stuff. And so it was just really more that person was not really involved anymore, and they were just not into it anymore. They had found something else that they wanted to do, and that's fine. It created a huge pain in the neck for me, but
it all worked out in the end.
It all worked out, right? So I guess I can't really complain about it, because right now I've had a few Zengachi releases at some conventions and stuff. I've had one online release. And I'm working on another one, probably like maybe October or November, depending on how good that goes.
Nice.
So for people that are want, like, how do I get my toy made or whatever, I would say make your own like ground yourself and make your own connections and stuff first. And if you can do like a Kickstarter or something like that, you know, that doesn't work all the time. I didn't do that or anything like that. I've seen, you know, toy Kickstarters fail and stuff before. But if you can get enough people behind you, if you can, you know, do all that, if you can do it by yourself, that's even better, because then you can kind of like spring it on people and then you can market it correctly and stuff like that. I think that, you just gotta, you also like be patient. Don't like, being patient that entire time and being, you know, calm about it, being, you know, not like overly pissed off or anything like that. I think that definitely did help me in the end, because, being nicer to people kind of gets you places a little bit better sometimes. It might not get you there faster than yelling at somebody, but, and like kind of breathing down the back of their neck or anything. But, I think that, you know, trying to be honest and true and you know, good to people and stuff, I think that's gotten pretty far in this little culture so far. So so definitely get a good solid design going, then get your connections through, you know some people aren't gonna answer your questions, so maybe ask around, get multiple opinions. If you're I've noticed recently that, you know, getting your stuff produced in China is a lot easier. If you don't have any hookups with something like that, you know, or, you know, hookups in the sense of, you know, you don't mind it being a Chinese, vinyl toy rather than a Japanese vinyl toy or something like that, just do it. You know, get your toy made, man. Like, do whatever you gotta do, to get it done, because that's your design, that's your baby. You know, this is your idea, and I don't think there's any greater fulfillment as a toy maker than bringing into the world something and people enjoying it, or, you know, having any kind of opinion about it, for that matter, is very fulfilling. Keep at it. what was the last part of that question?
Chin up. It was about articulation, but I think...
That's right. How did I get that? I looking back now, I probably would have been more specific about Zengachi's legs. But then again, I don't mind the way that he stands or anything like that. I don't mind the leg articulation. I think it works fine. How I worked out the articulation was, I kind of just wanted a character with four arms, because I had not really seen, there's plenty of humanoid, you know, designs out there, but I had not really seen too many four-armed, you know, creatures or anything like that. And I was like, that'd be kind of cool to do. Maybe it would be kind of ambitious for a first toy as well. So I tried to kind of go like the ambitious route, you know, making them 9 inches tall, doing the four arms, and then, you know, I kind of just wanted to do the legs too, just to throw it in there and stuff. So that was me being a very novice, like not knowing how a lot of these toys work or get made or something like that. So I would definitely, when you're looking into getting your toy made or whatever, definitely, you know, dissect in it, like really get into how certain toys are made. If you're going for a certain style, like say, for instance, say you want to make a gross hunchback guy or something like that, like look at other toys like that or something like that to maybe, not mimic, but maybe understand how their proportions work, you know, how they're able to stand or something like that. Like I said, I kind of modeled a lot of Zengachi off vintage, Ultraman figures or something like that. Mm-hmm. So yeah, even like M1 or something like that, I think modeled Zengachi off of like a lot of their like, you know, stand, you know, upright standing kind of feel and stuff like that. So yeah. Hope that helped. I don't ever know if my answers help anybody.
I'm sure they do. I'm actually curious. After you went through the long and arduous process of getting your toy produced, once those molds are made and you've gotten your first pull, how long mm-hmm. is the turnaround if you're like, hey, I need 10 more of this guy?
Sure.
Yeah, like because of the lineup and the wait time to get these things produced.
Right. Yeah. I think it it really depends on, like for me, again, not a normal experience. I had gotten a test pull from that person who had kind of given up. And it was like another, I want to say like 4 or 5 months before I had gotten sick of emailing them, waiting around and being like, I want more, please. So that's when I had decided to change liaisons, if you will. Representative in Japan at the factory to, you know, do the pulls for me. And so, but after that, now it's like, you know, I would probably say only a couple weeks, to get something in, going. And it really depends on the person's schedule who's pulling them and stuff as well. Also it helps if you, for me, when I first went in there, I was like, I want purple and I want green and I had these ideas, but, I had to pivot because, if you want it faster, maybe don't be so picky with the colors. Maybe whatever color they got at the factory is
what you're working with. Yeah.
Toy faster. So, you know, stuff like that, can get you your toy a little bit faster.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And I imagine like, black and flesh are probably like the easiest. It's like they probably always have those on tap.
Maybe, yeah. Black was probably my it was the second color that I had done, and then flesh was the first color I had done. The flesh was a little bit more tan. It was like not like tan as in like tan skin, but it was like sandy, like a tan, like a army tan kind of color or something like that. But yeah, I loved both of those colors, you know. I guess I'll give a little hint at maybe what might be coming next. A little spooky season color, maybe.
Oh.
A little, little Jack Lantern action, maybe.
I think he's hinting at orange.
fruit orange. So that's kind of what we got working.
Very cool.
Yeah.
Lucas asks, what kind of collection reactions do horror collectors get?
Oh yeah. Usually seething jealousy. No, I'm sorry. I love showing my horror friends, toys from horror movies that they love or that they've never seen before or something like that. That is always really, really cool. I love, they'll be like, well, they made that, that movie's insane. Every time I get a new edition to I have a Belial collection from Basket Case or something like that, I'll post a picture of all of them together, or, Jason or something like that. And it's always really cool to see, the reactions that they get. Usually it's like, holy shit, where do you have room for stuff, or where do you put all that, or what do you do is usually I get the main question. What do I do,
like for a living?
yeah is usually what I get. How do you get all that stuff, where do you get all that stuff, stuff like that.
Mm-hmm.
The typical, give me the 411. what are your toy collections like? I always really enjoy horror fans, horror collectors and stuff like that, because it definitely fuels my creative energy, and I know it fuels a lot of other people's creative energy out there. So seeing getting more acolytes, if you will, getting more people joining to your cause, and you're just like, yes, the power, it's growing.
It's like what I see when like one person joins the Discord. I'm like, holy fuck, I better go introduce myself.
I'm becoming powerful, more powerful than I could possibly imagine.
Hachimaki wants to say thanks for getting him into collecting Sofubi with your Sofubi World video.
Thank you for watching. I appreciate it. Thank you so much.
And he wants to know what horror exploitation movie, character you would like to see a Sofubi made of, which is a question we get all the time. It's a question Tony and I have answered in like 1,000 different forms. It's like, what toy doesn't exist that you wish exists? It's just like, oh my
yeah,
God,
yeah.
All of them. And then in brackets, well, we've got, please don't say more Belial.
Yes. Yeah. I had read that one, and I had put some thought into it. I would probably say, not Belial, but, maybe Elmer from Brain Damage would be a really cool one. It's like this worm thing. It gives you this drug in your brain. It's pretty good. By the same director, Frank Henlotte. But I picked two that would probably be like even maybe a possibility for me in the future. Number one, Class of Nukem High, the nuclear sperm in full form.
Okay.
Class of Nukem High, they smoke this radioactive weed, and then this couple, they do it, and then she, has this like nuclear sperm baby at school. And he like gets flushed down the toilet, and then he gets like plopped into some nuclear waste, so then he becomes even stronger. He's got like all these quills on his back. He's kind of like a sluggy guy. He's got like this big long tail. You never really see like a really full on image of him in Class of Nukem High, but I would love to kind of like create my own version of that guy or something like that.
Hell yeah.
Maybe even Tromi, the giant rat. Mm-hmm. From the sequels of Class of Nukem High, or there was even a Toxic Crusaders, like, Godzilla, like, sliming Godzilla walker thing that would be really cool to, like, make an homage to that, because, like, that never got released, so that would be really cool to make something like that for people. But then my second choice was, there's this movie called Prophecy, and, not the Christopher Walken one. This one is about a mutated radioactive bear. You see a theme here going, guys? This bear is what influenced Man Bear Pig from the South Park
Okay.
skit. I remember that little bit from there. And it is like it's a gigantic bear that walks on his two legs, and then like half of it is like mutilated, gross flesh, and it's so cool looking, and it has one of the greatest unintentional hilarious scenes in any horror movie, I think, where it attacks this campsite, and it's the 80s, so of course children die in it. This kid
there's just lots of children death.
This kid is in his yellow sleeping bag, and he's like stuck in it, so he gets up and he tries to like hop away in the sleeping bag, and the bear like smacks him, and he flies into a tree, and just poof, like a big cloud of cotton goes everywhere, and it's the most unintentionally hilarious thing ever. I love it. And so that would be I would make the bear, right, like a big, like probably like a 9 or 10 inch bear, and then the omake would be like the kid in the sleeping bag.
Awesome.
So that would probably be. So I did put some thought into that question.
Nice. I'm sure Hachimaki will be stoked.
I hope.
You've got fans later on our Discord, by the way.
Oh, you're wow! Fans. Thank
the,
you. Guys.
The people are into it.
I'll stick around then.
Yeah, I was gonna delete this fucking app right after, but.
Well, it's funny because I use Discord for another like business thing that I do with my dad, so
yeah.
To keep in touch with him and the rest of my family. So yeah. I was like, oh, we're using Discord, cool. Yeah. Something I actually know what I'm doing. Yeah.
Nice. Sam would like to know, what is the hardest part about learning to airbrush? He wants a full airbrushing tutorial right now. All go.
Right. Step A, go to Amazon. Step B, type in airbrush set on Amazon search bar.
Don't buy the cheapest one, buy the second cheapest one.
Yeah, buy like the second cheapest one, I would probably say. You know, your first airbrush is, I got a combo set, like, you know, like the little shitty ass compressor that overheats and shuts down. And then I got like a simple gravity fed airbrush for my first one. You don't have to start out like professional right away. You can get some cheap shitty stuff to start out with, you know, like you don't, like if you find out that it's not for you and you want to do some kind of different painting, like hand painting or something like that, you know, you don't want to be out like a shit ton of money because, yeah, you know, and feel like you're obligated to do it or whatever. That being said, I would say probably the hardest part of airbrushing, learning how to transition and like fade colors is pretty tricky. But that just comes with time, you know. You overlap certain colors and you go, that looks like shit together, or you go, hey, that looks pretty cool together, you know, like using see-through colors, you can usually get some really beautiful transitions. And you can also here's a good one for people who want to airbrush. Gun maintenance is probably my biggest handicap. I suck at taking care of things because I am so impatient. I'm also very messy. So like my workspace is messy. So then like, you know, you get all enthralled with like finishing a project or whatever. And then sometimes I'll like forget to like clean my gun completely or something like that. So definitely get in the habit of taking apart your gun, cleaning it out. I would say maybe get like a small oil tray and put it on like a tray so that none of the parts roll all over the place or whatever, and you lose it, and it's, you know, goes down a drain or goes, you know, down a, you know, flies underneath your workbench or something like that, and it's unobtainable, gone to the third dimension. Now you need to go to Lowe's and, you know, bring your damn airbrush with you to get, you know, a new bushel or something like that, you know, bushing or whatever. So, the gun is probably the biggest pain in the ass. Like when I first started painting, I went through like four or five guns like every couple months because I was horrible at taking care of them. And I would put clear coat inside my airbrush and then I would just like destroy it. So find your own way of doing something and then refine it until the point where it's like just muscle memory and you can sit down, do it with your eyes closed, you know, and you can, you know, get your brain thinking about what you're going to be doing while you're doing it and stuff. I think it's a great little ritual to have before and after or whatever, your airbrush or whatever. So, yeah, hope that helped.
Yeah, definitely. It's funny, whenever we have anybody on, everybody has so many, like...
nightmare horror stories?
No, just, like, workflow-related questions about making toys or painting toys. I think we've got a bunch of up-and-coming artists just waiting for the time to strike. Like,
That's great, because... you know, like I said earlier, we need the pond always needs more fish, mm-hmm. more to eat. more to keep things going and keep things fresh and keep, us, you know, people who are already involved or already, I'll use the term established reluctantly. It'll keep us on our toes, right? Mm-hmm. You know, keep us striving to stay where we are, keep going further. Reach higher and higher.
And I've definitely said it before. There's nothing more like romantic than the idea of making your own toy. Like I think every collector somewhere in their brain is their concept for their perfect toy or the thing they would make. And I think the fact that like people like you and people like Nate the Milkman, like all the people we've talked to so far that are Sofubi guys, like the fact that everybody's just wants to help and is excited for just the art form as a whole, right? And I think like the more of that there is going around and the more people like hear these questions and they're like, yeah, maybe try this and this, like maybe that's going to inspire them to finally take the plunge and be like, fuck it, you know what, I will make this toy that I've thought about. And we've all thought about them all day, every day. Like we all think about that thing that would be cool to make. And hopefully by talking about this stuff, we can inspire others to just actually pull the trigger and just say, today is the day that I make my toy, make my concept a reality.
Don't wait anymore. You know, if you got something rattling around in your brain, you know, put it down on paper or whatever. Toxic Writer was just a scribble on paper and a kitbash toy for like a couple of years before, you know, now his prototype sitting on one of my shelves right now, waiting his turn for glory or whatever, you know? Yeah. So, yeah, definitely don't, be the artist that you want to see in the toy scene, make the toy that you want to see in the toy scene. And be the kind of person that you wanted to be when you were starting out later on, you know, I guess, because like, there's a lot of like, do this now, but I don't think there's enough of, you know, be this way when you're or a little bit more established or whatever. Mm-hmm. I would say don't just kind of, you know, just, I don't want to say stay humble or anything, but like, you know,
I mean, just, stay humble is good,
but just, you know, I think, keeping your ear close to the ground and, you know, and like, what's really cool and what really helps me a lot is talking to other people. Mm-hmm. I know that that's one of the other questions, like what inspires me or whatever. So I'll hold back on that. But yeah, like talking to other people and stuff, especially younger artists and more up and coming artists is what really fuels a lot of my passion and stuff as well, because it's surrounding yourself with people that are very into what you're doing and they're doing. It's just kind of it's a nice way to keep you going. It's a nice way to, you know, keep propelling you to where you're supposed to be, you know, in this crazy world or whatever.
Quick has a question for us here. Do videos vomit and then like confused watching emoji?
The vice versa can happen many times. Vomits can video. I've seen it many times on YouTube. But I think... do videos vomit? Yes. The idea behind video vomit, like the video store, the VHS era, that kind of stuff, and a vomit of the ideas, a vomit of the imagery. I think that just those two words together compiled with one another, I think it just really kind of captured the vibe I was going for, that sleazy underbelly 1986 kind of, exploitation, sleazy, trash kind of stuff that I'm into. And and that's the kind of toy company I am. I'm sleazy, I'm trash. I get that a lot. I get that, like, what does it mean? You know, what's it about? Do videos vomit? That's the first one I've ever got. So thank you for that one.
I think your answer was far more than what was expected from that kind of a throwaway question.
That's what I was going for. I just really wanted to get into that. it's a, he was doing the thinker. He was really pondering it. Yeah. So I really wanted to oblige him.
Yeah. Thanks, Quick. Jake the Snake asks, how did you start collecting and what inspires you to keep creating content and art?
Okay, yeah. Well,
you thought about this earlier, like you were saying.
Collecting toys, just in general, I would say, was my mom. She got me my first action figure and vehicle together. She worked at a distribution center for Sam's Club. And there's a smash to shit Batwing box from the animated series.
Mm-hmm.
And so it was damaged, so she stole it. then she stopped on her way home and got me a Batman action figure as well. And so I remember getting those and just being like, well, this is amazing, you know, like now I can like recreate the movie and stuff, you know, like mm-hmm. do stuff like that. And so, and when I was a kid, I moved around a lot as a kid. My dad was a manager for Walmart, and that's pretty much like being a military brat.
Yeah.
You get bounced around all over the country. So I didn't really have a lot of friends, or I didn't have a lot of stuff, to kind of entertain me until I started getting toys and comics and, you know, video games and all that stuff. And then that like fueled my creativity and my imagination. And like, you know, I remember getting like, Predator stuff and just being so excited, so in like blown away. You know, RoboCop was a big one for me when I was a kid too. So like collecting started with action figures. Collecting for vinyl toys and stuff like that started with Max Toyko, like we had talked about a little bit mm-hmm. earlier. I remember seeing Max Toyko stuff and just being like, oh man, so cute, so amazing. And then seeing Izon for the first time, the first, like the more upright Izon, rather than the Izon Evolved, and being really into that. And then I remember seeing a lot of, YouTubers and musicians and stuff, collect vinyl toys, and like I would see them in the backgrounds of their stuff. I remember, from Bring the Horizon, Oli Sykes, the lead singer, he had some Max Toyko stuff. And I remember being like, holy shit, he has Max Toyko stuff. That's crazy, you know, and being really into that and being like, oh, maybe I should look into that myself or, you know, and then, I had gotten those mini cats and stuff and I had started painting those. I remember, I had just moved into an apartment and they had, Monster Color had a sale for a bunch of clear, mini Necrons and Izon. And so I had bought like, like 10 of them. And I was like, yeah, I'm going to paint all these. I'm going to sell them. And so I remember that was like my first little like, you know, entrance into like customization and all that stuff. So yeah, that's what really got me going and got me started on all this stuff. And then slowly I was like, yes, I got to build. I got to keep building all that stuff. Gundam was another huge thing for me when I was a kid too, was collecting Gundams. The Bandai like action figure ones.
Yeah. Yeah.
I had built a lot of the models at first, and then, you know, if you wanted to play with them or like mix their parts up or anything like that, like I like to do a lot as a kid, I like to take things apart and like mix their parts, make my own, you know, Gundam or whatever. I remember the models didn't last very long for me.
Those poly caps would wear out pretty quick.
Yes. Yeah. And then, so I ended up collecting those plastic action figures and stuff. They're pretty cool. They're like I think they're like 4 inches or something like that. MISA is what they call them, that MISA or something like that, when you look them up on eBay or something. Anyway. yeah. So I've been collecting a long time, you know, lots of stuff. And then the stuff that gets me really passionate and keep going is seeing all the new stuff coming out. You know, seeing just how creative people can be with the new toy stuff, you know, with new vinyl, you know, shit, man, like Acid Rain, like we had mentioned that before. You know, seeing all their new designs and stuff like that is really cool. I just love, like, you know, I was saying, you know, put the stuff out into the world that you want to see. also seeing stuff that I've always wanted to see in the world come out, and I'm like, shit, I need this. You know, like Figma made a Bloodborne hunter figure, and I was like, oh god, it's $89. But I need it. Yeah. So I'm going to get it. I just got a shipping notification that it was shipping. I was like, yes! So, anytime there's something that you're like, damn, there needs to be a toy of that, you know, and then when it finally comes out, or, you know, when you finally see that, you know, man, I wish they made, you know, a retro 50s style robot with his brain rattling around in a bubble or something like that, you know, the chances are it's already made or someone's going to do it or, you know, it's on the way, you know, or something like that. So that's what keeps me going is that I know that, you know, I might have not won that lottery that I want, might have not gotten that retro band piece I was, you know, willing to kill another human for, but chances are there's going to be another retro band piece or there's going to be another, you know, piece out
retro
there.
Retro band was actually a big part of my toy awakening.
When
that's awesome. When he did the King Star King Hank Waffles.
Oh, yeah.
I saw that and my mind was fucking blown. And then that's part of what inspired me to like start doing resin stuff.
That's so cool.
Yeah.
Did you ever get one of those or
no?
Oh, that's sad. I'm sorry.
Single,
one day,
single tier.
Your chance.
Single.
Hey,
tier.
Hey, someone listening, send it on over.
Yeah. yeah. That
are
was.
Are they really?
Yeah, I imagine. I don't think he made too many. I think they might have even been like gifts for people who worked at Adult Swim. Like it was a commission Adult Swim did.
Because I know he did the Tom robot, too, which was really, really cool for the competition. They had, like, a little, like, raffle or giveaway or something like that. He did, like, the Tom robot, and I was like, oh, fuck, that's awesome. I always wanted the Tom robot, you know, action figure. I was like, why didn't Cartoon Network ever do that? You know, like, make a plush, make a window cling of him or some a bendable figure? I don't know.
Anything.
I think that they created, like, such a great design, you know, and all the Toms over the years for Toonami or whatever.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Retro Band, I remember I had gotten stickers from him, his spray painted giant stickers he had of like They Live and The Stuff and Toxic Avenger and stuff like that. I put, I remember I had put up, the Stuff sticker that he made on a yield sign near my apartment. So then every time I was like coming in and out of my apartment, there's this Retro Band, The Stuff sign or sticker just hanging out on that sign. I was like, yay.
Nice.
It just brought my day a little bit of sunshine every day that I passed it.
That's
it's gone now, unfortunately. Someone scraped it off.
Some do-gooder came by and cleaned up the streets.
Cleaning up.
Hachi Mackie asks, what devil did you make a deal with to be able to afford so many figures and so win so many lotteries? That's similar to the, like, what do you do? Like, how do you afford to collect?
Okay, so I'm going to pull the Tommy Wiseau card, and I'm not going to tell anybody what I do for a living.
Okay.
Off in front of a camera for a living. No, I'm just kidding.
Dude, my Pornhub site is blowing up. You think Video Vomit's doing well?
My Pornhub's link is... No. For lotteries, I have no clue. I never won any of them, ever. And then, I think I'm just on a really good streak right now, to be honest.
Knock on wood again.
Yes. I'm very, very superstitious.
Knock on that wood, dude.
Talking about it is like, dude, I'm tempting fate. Like the next lottery I enter is good. I'm not going to get it. But I think, there are certain lotteries that, like, I think I'm cursed with that I never win, like MVH lotteries I never win.
Mm-hmm.
Tokum lotteries, I think I won two out of, like, every single one I've ever entered. I have no clue. Maybe the Sifubi gods are just, like, here's looking at you, kid. I don't know. I'm not really sure how to answer that question. Just being a good person and being super nice, I think you get whatever you want in the future. I don't know.
I went my luck at 5 points, because I was crazy lucky at 5 points. I won all the lottos I entered.
That's so awesome, dude.
But
congratulations.
I think that's because... Like, cause I was going hard on, like, Real Head Skull Toys Punk Drunkers, and there was...
I see that Punk Drunkers Spider-Man behind you.
Oh, yeah, he's hanging out.
that's a grail for me. I wasn't able to go into the lottery while I was there, so I was like, oh no, it's so beautiful.
But so they had multiples. They had, I think, four different guys they were offering up, but I only and you could get a ticket for each, but I only took tickets for the two that I wanted. Because I was like, I'm going to hopefully get the things I want. I don't want to win something that some other collector wants. And hopefully I get it. And then I think it was, that was the moment the Sufubi gods were like, this man has done a good deed. give him the bounty he seeks. Oh, that was actually a question I wanted to ask you about. How do you feel about them flippers?
Oh, I've been flipped. My toy's been flipped, unsuccessfully. They haven't sold it.
It's on eBay for like $2,000, and you're like, nobody's paying that much, dude.
I think it was like $50 more than I think it originally was. Okay. No, it was like $122 or something like that, and I think it was like originally $80. So, you want to do the math on there? You do math. How I feel about them? I think that, unfortunately, they are part of our ecosystem at this point. You know, you have your sites where you can get stuff from. You know, like, I know people have a love-hate relationship with Mandarake. Mm-hmm. And, you know, that's how I get a lot of stuff that I miss out on. You know, like, I had gotten a Myrock toy piece that I had been missing out on. I got it from Mandarake. And, so I guess it depends on your definition of like how minute do you want to get with it. The guys who flip the shit for like, or people who flip the shit for like thousands of dollars when it's totally not worth that, or, you know, you're doing like $100+ addition onto the price tag. Yeah, fuck you. Mm-hmm. Definitely go to hell. And then you have those other people that, you know, whatever reason they're doing it for, you know, you know, they got a surgery to pay for, or they just got a car accident or something like that. I guess I can understand stuff like that too. I've definitely bought secondhand off of people and stuff before. But it's a slippery slope, but most of all, just screw the people that are trying to,
one over people. Yeah.
Yeah. Take advantage of people and really get like air quotes rich off the scene, you know, because, you know, it's really damaging and it's really discouraging for people. I know I can only imagine how discouraging it is for people that are like just they found Mutant Vile Hardcore or something. They found Splurt for the first time and they're like, holy shit, this is some of the coolest stuff I've ever seen in my life. Or they see a Punk Drunkers piece. Punk Drunkers is a great example. Mm-hmm. Like I really want one, but you know, I'm not going to pay as much as these flippers are asking for. And it's everywhere. You know, it's you can tell what's hype at the moment because of the flipper prices and stuff. So, you know,
yeah. Spider-Man? What was he? Was he 1,000 the same day? Like 1,000, 2,000?
I don't know. I know that they are now, but I think it's just that some of those brands that are just, they're hot right now. They're real hype. So a lot of people are going to, you know, they want to take advantage of that hype, you know? And so it kind of like, it's almost like a snake eating its own tail at that point, because it's like, it's good that the toy is doing really well and the people are very excited about it. And that it, you know, it's selling out and all that stuff. That's really awesome. And that the demand for the toys at an all high, because that's really good as well. But then you have the problem of, well, you know, there are certain people that are going to get slipped past, that are going to get a hold of one. They're going to flip it for way more than it's worth. Or no, I won't say that. They're going to flip it way more than what they paid for it. And, because worth is, what is it worth to you is different to how much it's worth to me. Like, I've definitely paid overpriced for toys before. You know, on the second aftermarket market, especially blanks. Like, if you're a blank hunter, god damn, I sympathize with you, because sometimes, man, those blanks will really, really dent your wallet. Really put a nail in that wallet of yours. So yeah.
They're here to stay. You know.
Yeah, they're here to stay. So it's just one of those things that we have to navigate around. I think that a lot of people are taking a lot of interesting and clever initiative to negate them or kind of, you know, screw them over, which I agree. You know, if they're trying to screw you over, you're the artist that's getting screwed over because your toy is being sold for like five times the amount that you sell it for. That's probably a punch in the gut for you as an artist, you know, because you're just like, you know, yeah. It probably feels good in the sense of like, yay, there's a demand, but also it's just like, man, people are getting taken advantage over my toy and they're not even getting it from me. You know, they're getting it from some asshole who took it from me or who got it off me, you know, so I can sympathize with that. So
yeah,
it sucks. They suck.
Yeah. It was like,
send them back to the Funkos. Let them flip Funkos. Let them do all that shit. Get off our turf.
Yeah, man. It just bummed me out when I was at 5 points. There was some fucking guy, and obviously he had tons of people online for him, because he's holding like a fistful of tickets, and he's up at the front, and he's demanding that he's won, and he doesn't even realize that like there's different colored tickets for each one. So yes, the number, let's say 10 won, but not for that one.
Orange,
yeah,
green, or whatever.
And he's just like getting really upset, and I'm there trying to do my thing, and I was just so angry, I was fuming. I'm like, what is like wrong with your brain, and like how like detached like are you that you think that that's acceptable behavior to like farm these tickets? You don't even know what you're buying, and you're shoving them in the artist's face saying, give me the stuff I just won, and you don't even know what the fuck it is.
That's way, way, way past over the line. That's way past being, you know, an asshole. That's to the point of you just being the worst.
Yeah.
You know?
Just garbage person.
And I've seen that stuff. I saw it at DesignerCon. I saw it at 5 points, you know. I can understand the muling thing, you know, like if there's someone who wasn't able to make it or whatever, and you have a good enough friend who can get something for you, and it's not like you're hurting them or whatever. Sure. Like I've had it where I wasn't able to leave my booth and I had someone get something for me. You know, that's cool.
Yeah.
That was really cool of them. You know, and like, I didn't, they didn't catch like any money off of me or any commission. They're like, no, here you go. You couldn't leave. So, you know, I got what I wanted. You got what you wanted, you know, so that's really cool. So I like stuff like that. That's part of like the community doing their thing, you know, but then there's the difference between like, you know, like you were saying, like the dude with like 12 tickets just going in there, you know, with his head up his ass, you know, so that sucks. That just really sucks. It really sucks the fun out of it, because like when you're standing there with all these people and you all got the ticket, you know, it's pretty exciting, you know, especially you know that feeling, you won. So you know how awesome that feels. And like when I see it, I'm like, I'm behind the booth, you know, people are winning and they're coming up. They're like, yes, you know, like that's pretty cool. That's a really good feeling, because then, you know, that toy has a memory attached to it and it has sentimental value. And then you have somebody who's doing that just solely for profit, you know, coming up there, plowing through people, trying to take one, you know, catch a lick off everybody. It sucks. Yeah. It just really sucks. It's a wet blanket over a regularly very warm and inviting type of crowd, you know.
We do have one final question. Also, thank you so much for marathoning these questions. Like, Tony had a hard bounce, but you stuck it out. I appreciate that.
Oh, yeah, no worries at all.
So, a final one from Hachimaki. He says, have you ever had to get rid of a toy because your significant other thought it was gross and weird?
I had read this one. Thank you, Hachimaki, right?
Mm-hmm.
Thank you for that question. Thank you for all your questions today. No, I have not done that. If my words of wisdom to anyone, I don't know if you're in a relationship where they would ever do that to you, but that's probably not the right person. Give up the thing you love. Like, I mean, I've had girlfriends and stuff who aren't into the stuff as much as I am. Or completely uninterested, I should say. Those relationships weren't as fulfilling as to where being in a relationship with someone who really likes that stuff too. Granted, that's a tough order to fill, to find a significant other who can match your energy and dedication for that stuff. because then the chances are both of you are going to be poor if you're together, because you're both spending all your money on toys and not one of you supporting the other. But I have had two relationships where both of us were like big collectors and we love collecting things, and collecting is in my blood. It's in my family. A lot of my people on my mom's side collect and stuff like that. And, I've seen it in others, people's spouses where it's like, oh geez, another one of those, another one of this, you know, and it's like, you're coming home and you're feeling bad about it. And it's like, this is the thing that's supposed to make me feel better, not make me feel ashamed. Mm-hmm. And like, I've had enough shame about my love for toys and stuff like that when I was a kid, when I was a teenager, you know, like 12, 13 and on, you know, I had enough time feeling bad about that and trying to still collect as it was. So I don't need somebody that I want to like spend a great deal amount of time with. Why would I want them to make me feel bad about something like that? They should enjoy it as much as I do, because if it's part of me, then that's a part of them they should love or appreciate. So no, I haven't ever had that happen. I've had it where they're like, ew, he's nasty, or you know, something like that, but you know, nothing like, get him out of here.
can we
sell him? I don't want him here.
Can we throw a sheet over the toy shelf? It's really creeping me out right now.
Yeah, right. Like when I'm here, the sheet needs to go on. Okay. No.
Yeah, I think that's good life advice. It's like if someone is making you get rid of the things that bring you happiness, maybe that's not the best person. So maybe we gave some helpful life advice today.
Yeah, yeah. I listened to another podcast called Say You Love Satan. It's an 80s horror podcast. It's really cool. And the host from there, he had talked about Jessup. He had talked about he had been in a relationship where she had made him get rid of all of his horror stuff, like a shitload of his horror stuff. And then he had ended up marrying somebody who appreciated all that stuff. And he just kicks himself in the ass now because he got rid of all that stuff that he really loved. He had masks and props and all this stuff. And now he kicks himself that he lost all that stuff because it ended up working out for him anyway. You know? So it's like, If you're really meant to be with this person, does a shelf full of toys really change anything? Mm-hmm. It shouldn't, but you know, whatever. So definitely just you know, be yourself. Keep on collecting, collectors.
Yeah, love the shit you love, the amount you love it.
Yes. Is that all the questions for today?
That's the end of.
You have any other questions for me? I'd love to answer more of your questions.
You know, just good? I think we covered most of it.
Nice. Yeah. Good.
No, I really appreciate having you on the show. I've been trying to get you on for a long time, so thank you for bearing with me with all of my sort of dropped calls where it's like, we should do this thing, radio silence for 1 week.
No. That's kind of how a lot of this stuff works. Is I just kind of go, well, if they want it to happen, I said yes. So yeah. You know, I'll probably say yes to anybody wanting to work with me or do anything like this. I love to, you know, I love doing a YouTube show, mm-hmm. and I can't wait to keep doing that again and get back into that. And so, you know, I love getting a chance like this to come on here and interact with a whole other group of people. And you know, it's nice to finally talk with people that, some like-minded individual.
Absolutely. Yeah. That's something I took away from Five Points, is like, because I met so many people there that I know online, and like to get mm-hmm. to meet them face to face, and just like, again, how warm and welcoming so many people are. Well, everyone, honestly.
Yeah.
And just getting to meet all of these people who I know. I feel like I already know, like I felt like I already knew you when I went to go say hi. Yeah. It's like, hey, it's now this is a thing where we've seen each other's faces.
And I knew
faces.
It right away because we had all our conversations already and stuff. And it was like we had already had said hey that day earlier, and mm-hmm. we had just picked up another conversation or something like that from earlier in the day or something.
Yeah, and getting...
Yeah, that's how a lot of it is there. And that's so beautiful. You know, like I came back with like the biggest rainbow shooting out of my ass probably because I was just so like, yeah, mm-hmm. that was awesome. You know? And I come back and everyone's like, you're not the same person. You're, you know, it was like, because I was around people that were, you know, just as passionate, if not more, about the things that I'm doing, things that they're doing, you know, so stuff like that. It's a great revitalizing you know, recharging type of energy there, and really the nice kick in the ass when if you're feeling pretty down about what.
Yeah, totally. And that's maybe a big takeaway from all this is like, cause all of the people I met, like, don't be afraid, I think, to reach out to people whose work you're interested in, whose stuff you're interested in. Like Instagram's this amazing tool because we're all sharing photos of the things we love. And I think that's sort of the commonality of how I've met so many people is like, we're all taking the time to snap a pic of the thing we like, and you may not have people in your everyday life who understand it or who are a part of it, but those people who are liking your photos and those people who you're liking theirs, reach out to them because fun, cool shit can happen. Like this podcast, or it wouldn't have gone down like this if I hadn't slid into the DMs and said, hey, like the people that you love their work online, they're everyday people just like you and I. And so,
Everyone likes validation too. Everyone likes to be told, "Hey, your stuff is really good." I'd lie if I said that I didn't like when people said that stuff to me because it makes me feel better about what I'm doing and it makes me feel like I'm reaching people, right? Like I'm sure you feel the same way about they're like, "Hey, love podcasts. Hey, love this. Hey, love that." You know. So, also to kind of mirror what you were saying, definitely message people that. You know, if you find them inspirational or whatever, message them or comments or whatever, try and get in contact and just, have a little, something with them. And even if they don't reply at first, like I'm horrible at replying sometimes. There's different kinds of energy, right? There's being online and posting and liking things. And then there's like the conversation energy, So I think there's two different kinds of like aspects to that. So sometimes you're maybe not in the mood to talk, which is totally cool. I'll let something simmer for a day, and then I promise I will get back to you or something like that. Because my days are I'm always flying by the seat of my pants, so I never know what the hell I'm doing. So, if they don't reply, don't get discouraged. They have a life. They probably have kids or something like that. Don't get discouraged if they don't talk to you or something like that, right? Because I had that before where I talked to people and they did message me and I was like, shit, they hate me. And then later on, I'm like, I thought you hated me, or you're something like that, So, don't assume too much or don't, anything like that because, you never know. Because, I always feel bad when I leave people hanging, and I'm always like, I'm too busy right now or, I'm doing this right now. I can't really like, especially if I'm like in the zone, right? If you will, if I'm in the artistry zone, I try not to like talk to people or anything like that because, I'm like working on something and I kind of want to like dedicate all my focus to that. Cause I have a lot of focus, and stuff like that. So I try to harness my power.
It's growing.
Yes. I try to wrangle it in a way where it doesn't impede like my abilities or anything like that, where I don't, cause I'll tend to overthink things a lot of the time too. So I have anxieties and anxious and stuff like that. So I get super weird, sometimes and shit like that. So I'm just like, I'm so sorry. I have to restart. I have to reboot real quick. I'll be back to you in a moment, or something like that. When I'm at the cons and stuff like that too, it's very overwhelming. I like work myself into like a nervous panic and then I'm there and then it's totally normal and everyone's totally cool. And there was nothing to worry about in the first place, but I do it every time anyway, but he's sitting there like waiting in the Uber, like on my way there. And I'm like, Oh my God.
old friend anxiety.
Always with this gentle, bony hand on my shoulder.
All right. Well, thanks for tuning into the podcast, everybody. It's been a wonderful time. I'm doing my regular outro, except Tony's not here. So is there anything you would like to say to the people, John? Is there anything you want to plug before we get out of here?
Yeah, sure. You can catch me shit posting on the reg on Instagram. That's Video Vomit on Instagram. And then you can check out my feed of all my photography and stuff like that. I love doing toy photography is another one of my huge passions, and I love to incorporate that with Sifubi and stuff, so definitely check that stuff out. I have a YouTube channel. It's called The Bunker Network, and it's youtube.com/bunkernetwork. And you can check out some of my older videos that I've done there. You know, be sure to say hey if you discovered that from this podcast. Be sure to let me know, and I'll get back to you and say hey and shoot the shit on the comments or something like that. Other than that, yeah, I got Zengachi Tsufubi out right now, and then I'm gonna have some new ones of those real soon, and I'm gonna be doing a art show in Denver in October, which is gonna be pretty cool. So if any of you guys out there, be sure to keep your ear and eyes open for something like that. And I think that's about it. I just want to thank you for letting me be on the show again, and this has been really fun. I love talking, shooting the shit, talking shop. It's always great.
Yeah, no problem. Let's keep the thanks going. Thanks again to Video Vomit for coming to hang out on the altar. Oh, I almost plugged my YouTube instead of the podcast. Coming to hang out on Good Morning Toy World. And I just want to say thank you to you guys for listening. This is a marathon of an episode, so congratulations if you've made it to the end. So thanks to everyone involved. And remember, folks, a Boba Fett for a Greedo is a notoriously bad trade. We'll see you next time.
Okay, well, I'm gonna open this bag of Bugles.
Don't do it.